You're listening to the Final Draft Insider View, a podcast where we talk to screenwriters about writing and all the stuff in between writing and their careers and all the other good stuff that goes along with that. I'm Pete D'Alessandro. I'm your host and also the product manager here at Final Draft. Today, we're going to be interviewing Allison Schroeder. She wrote Hidden Figures. She was a writer on the movie that you can see out in theaters now that's nominated for a bunch of awards. She herself is nominated for Best Adapted Screenplay for the Oscars, for the Writers Guild of America, and for BAFTA. So, Allison, thank you so much for joining us.
Hi.
Let's talk about what your career trajectory was, because it sounds like you had an interesting story to get this far.
Yes. I think the moral is it doesn't actually happen overnight. I was at Stanford undergrad and graduated and went into finance and then didn't like that at all. So I went to USC Film School, and my first sort of job that was very exciting when I graduated was as an office PA on Pineapple Express, because we all start somewhere. And let me tell you, I was a very good grocery shopper and made some good coffee and actually really enjoyed the experience. You know, it was a great group of people, and Seth and Evan were very nice, and they would, you know, even let you stand in Video Village and sort of watch what was going on. And during that time, I was just doing a lot of writing in my spare hours and, you know, sending it out to any producer that would read it. And ultimately, the writing I did while I was a PA on Pineapple Express and a production assistant on Smallville led to my first actual writing job, which was as a staff writer on 90210.
That's great. So, all right. How did you make that transition? How did you make that jump?
To a staff writer?
Yeah.
It was about 2 years of just writing on spec. So I went to an alumni event and sort of found a mentor. And after about 6 months, I won like a little bitty writing competition. And so he read my pilot and he loved it. And then he read my next pilot and he loved it. And then I wrote, you know, a feature on spec, and you don't get paid for any of this, and none of it got made and none of it got sold. But when he and his writing partner became the showrunners on 90210, they called me up and said, do you want to be a staff writer? And I, of course, was sitting at Smallville in my assistant desk and, you know, went into my boss and was like, so I have to quit. And he was like, what? And I was like, yeah, I just got staffed on 90210. So It was incredible, and in a way it happened very fast, but it was also 2 years of building a relationship with a showrunner and writing for free and all that. So it was pretty incredible to get to move over. And so then it was just a matter of trying to stay a working writer, which is never easy.
Right. It's just as hard to get your second job as it is your first most times.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, the first, you know, they say it's hard to get your first job. That's the hardest thing to get. But it's also really hard to get your second, your third, your fourth, your fifth, your sixth. Like, It never ends as a writer having to, you know, find the next job.
Well, we're going to have to follow up in a year or two and see if being nominated for every award for writing maybe helps you. Yeah,
right,
let's hope that gets a little easier.
Does. Yeah, let's hope. Otherwise, I'm not sure what else to do at this point except keep writing.
Right. You did it for free first, so.
That's right. I can do it again.
Yeah, right. So what happened after 90210, and what was that experience like to be there?
I call it staff writer boot camp because we started without the pilot being shot. And so, you know, we were just hit the ground running, and it was a great experience. I learned a lot, hopefully grew up a little bit, you know, as a writer and understanding not only the creative side, but the business side of everything. And then I actually sold a pilot with Wilmer Valderrama to MTV, which was super fun. And again, never saw the light of day. Mm. And then, you know, both in the good and the bad became known for teen comedy. And so I ended up working in teen comedy a lot, but I didn't want to always be writing that. You know, people looked at me and they thought, well, clearly she can write teen and that's what she's good at and that's what we should pigeonhole her in. But I thought, that's actually not what I want to do. You know, I have a very big science and math background and I have a finance background and I want to write thrillers and action films and sci-fi. And so, again, just I wrote for free. I just wrote spec after spec. I wrote, I think, 4 or 5 pilots that have never seen the light of day, but we'd send them out and, you know, get if-come deals and hope for the best and you know, they go the way of most TV shows, or I would write spec feature films. And ultimately, one of them sold. It was about Agatha Christie, and it sold to Paramount. And that really helped me sort of break the stereotype and get into other genres. And that's how Donna Gelati, that was the sample she read, to hire me for Hidden Figures.
I see. What was the name of that spec, just in case we want to look it up?
Agatha. Okay. Yeah.
Cool.
And in real life, she went missing for 11 days and was found with amnesia. And this is my fictional take on what happened during those 11 days. And clearly, she saved us from, you know, the evil Germans and saved the world, because that's clearly what Agatha Christie did. And, you know, a little wish fulfillment.
I love that.
Yeah, it was great to write.
Cool. All right, so let's move on to, we're talking about Hidden Figures, so let's get right into it. What was the first thing? I mean, you take a meeting, or did you get a call? What happened first?
I got a call. I mean, the first thing that happened was, Renee Witt, Donna Gelati's executive, was looking for a writer for a few projects. And so they sent my manager the book proposal for Hidden Figures after reading Agatha. And they had no idea that I was what I call a NASA baby. So I grew up by Cape Canaveral. My grandparents worked there. I worked there. And I got on the phone with them and said, you know, very cheesily, you know, I was born to write this. You have to hire me. And I think Donna just rolled her eyes like, ugh, these Hollywood writers will say anything. but then I proceeded to tell her my history and that, you know, I had learned programming and binary coding and all that while at NASA growing up, and that, you know, then I'd gone to Stanford and done a lot of math for my major and worked at a missile launch company. And she started to go, okay, maybe she really is meant to write this. And that's honestly how I got hired. I pitched them a few scenes and off we went.
Wow. What was the pitch like? What were the scenes, or what was the first piece at least that spoke to you that you knew you could translate to them?
Right. I mean, one of the first things was just the ending, which was the idea that John Glenn really asked her to run those numbers. And so I pitched sort of the idea of, and he's, you know, trying to go to the launch pad, but they need the calculations. And so she's frantically writing and the countdown clock is going, and will she or won't she make it? And they were like, we don't understand the math, but that sounds exciting. so that was one of the first things. And then the other thing was just the idea of subverting stereotypes. So I had read, you know, about their dress code and the pearls and the heels and the skirts. And I thought, but, you know, they're engineers, some of them. And wouldn't it be great to see nylons and pumps poking out from underneath the capsule on a slider? And it's a famous mechanic. And that ultimately ended up in the final film as Dorothy Vaughn, Octavia Spencer's character, underneath the engine of the car.
Right.
And it's just such a great image, right, that we subvert the expectations with that.
Right. One of the things that really blew me away was that I was born in 1980, and at the time I was, you know, by the time I was five, I realized that segregation was a really long time ago.
Right.
And watching this film, I realized it wasn't.
Right.
And to see, you know, a NASA bathroom segregation thing, that was just mind-blowing, and it really brought it home to me in a way that I wasn't expecting.
Right. I mean, I think it is closer than we realize.
Yeah.
And, you know, that bathroom scene all came from actually Mary Jackson. And it was her experience that she'd asked for the colored restroom, and a bunch of sort of white women had laughed at her. And she found out that it was all the way back on the old campus. Mm-hmm. And it really drove her nuts that she had these pumps that she had to wear all the time. And it just didn't quite work in the screenplay for Mary Jackson's character, so we transposed it to Catherine, because I thought, how can we not, such a simple thing, right? A bathroom. And then I read about what they had to wear, and I thought, how can we not show the just such a simple injustice of that really hot, you know, Virginia summer and that really, really cold Virginia winter, and these women have to walk outside for half a mile to the bathroom.
Right.
And I just thought it was an important storyline to include. And so it became Catherine's.
Yeah, I see. I mean, condensing that into that, that seems like a great choice in retrospect.
Thanks.
What were the other? Sorry.
Well, I just also thought that's something that a male boss wouldn't think about, right? Like, it just wouldn't even occur to him. And so it's not an outright villainous thing. It was just obliviousness. And you know, in real life when all of their bosses sort of became aware of the segregation that they were facing in the worst place, they took steps to reverse it.
Right, right. That was really powerful. And I think that was maybe what snapped me out of that and made me really appreciate what that challenge was for these characters and really for these people that brought it home so much for me. What were some of the other choices you had to make to, you know, you condensed one kind of real person storyline into someone else's for right. cinematic reasons. What were some of the other choices you had to do like that?
I mean, a lot of it was sort of the timeline was very tricky. Hmm. So, you know, the book spans many, many decades and some incredible women. And so having to pick which women to focus on is very hard mm-hmm. because, for instance, Christine Darden was an incredible scientist in her own right, but she was the next generation. And so ultimately, you know, she just didn't fit into the timeline of the movie. And then, you know, sliding the timelines around, but it all happened around John Lynn's mission. But did Dorothy really get promoted the same day as the launch, you know, the same day that no, I mean, that's just movie magic. So just playing with that. And, you know, the first draft that I did for Donna, you know, way back in the beginning, I was very, very close to the truth and just really didactic with, okay, this is the timeline of events and this is what happened. Right. And then she's like, okay, you got it, but now have fun. You know, go back in and have fun with these characters and their humor and and you can invent some stuff. And I was like, okay, right. And so that was sort of the second step, is letting go a bit of the research and just having a little bit more fun, which I think ultimately was very necessary because these women end up being incredibly complicated and layered because of it. You know?
Right. Were there any other changes you were doing from, you know, kind of the adaptation or from the book to the adaptation?
Well, what was interesting was that at the time, Margot hadn't written the book yet. It was just a book proposal.
Ah.
And so Margot just gave me all of her data. She was wonderful, and all of her research. And I would sort of call her up and be like, okay, what does the punch code coding look like? Like, can I, you know, can they really be doing it? She said yes. And she would send me, you know, a video, and then I'd come back and forth. And so she was an incredible resource. But it is sort of funny now because people will say, you know, why didn't you include what was in the book in the movie? And I said, because I didn't know that scene existed yet. So I joke we'll have to do it at Hidden Figures too, so that we can get it all in there.
That's great. All right. Well, yes, like you said, there's a second generation. So
exactly.
So you picked a couple of these characters from out of history. Mm-hmm. Who were some of the people that the other people you left behind, even as their peers? Because there's this whole
right.
You know. Group
There's
of
a whole
women.
Group of them. Yeah. Gloria Rhodes was one of the ones that had to hit the early on in the writing process, hit the cutting room floor. And she was a single white mother in the other computing group and ended up befriending the ladies and, you know, had a very close friendship. And she was sort of ostracized for being a single unmarried mother, and so she related to them, and I believe it was Dorothy Vaughan and her ended up becoming incredibly close and working for the advancement of women throughout their careers. And they even, some of the white women, it was very divided, and so some of the white women invited some of the black computers to a potluck and incurred the wrath of the other white computers. And so you know, at one point we played with some of that stuff, but ultimately it was getting to be a lot. But there is one scene that hit the cutting room floor in shooting where you learn that Kirsten Dunst's character, Vivian, is going through a divorce. Mm-hmm. And that was sort of a nod back to Gloria Rhodes and how that made that character sort of insecure that she, too, would sort of become an outsider. But, you know, you just have to pick who you can fit in, and ultimately you want to hit the themes, right? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, when Ted came on board and the actress came on board and Kirsten Dunst came on board, that character just shifted to represent the barrier for Dorothy, right?
Right, right. And that was very clear. I mean, she had to fight against that kind of antagonist, really,
exactly.
for the movie.
And so those are the adjustments that, you know, we made while writing, which is just sometimes you have to take one character and just let them be the symbol of what was happening to them at the time.
Mm-hmm. Were you familiar with the characters before this material came to you?
I was not. I mean, I definitely knew women had worked at NASA because my grandmother was a programmer in the 60s, but mm-hmm. I had no idea about Catherine, Dorothy, and Mary. And, you know, as you read it, you just keep going, oh my God, really? Like, really? Like, how is this true? And I know when Octavia Spencer read the script very early, and she thought it was a work of fiction. And, you know, when she found out that it was all true, she was sort of equally aghast that these women's stories weren't known.
Right.
You know, and it's even, there's sort of this famous picture of the ENAC machines from World War One, and it's in textbooks since like early computing. And the irony of that photograph that, you know, was pretty iconic within certain circles is they cropped out the two women that were working it.
Wow.
And it's just moments like that that it's like, no, we need to reclaim the history we've lost.
Right. Right. Very much. Non-history question, but I'm dying to know. Yes. Because I tried to follow as much as I possibly could every blackboard, but my math is nowhere near good enough to understand. Did you understand the math?
I definitely can do the math that she did, the little girl did. Mm-hmm. I'm on that. I can do the quadratic formula. I probably would have cheated and only factored out one of them and done the quadratic for the other. But the fact that I even remember the quadratic formula and can still perform it, I feel like is pretty good for most writers.
It's definitely pretty good, right?
So I checked that math, you know, when I watched it. But I understood the theory if you'd asked me to act. I mean, she was doing cosine and sine in her head, which is just bananas. You know, like, no, I can't do that in my head. You'd have to give me the chart. But it was, like, one of the early things was, how do we make math palpable to the audience, right? Mm-hmm. And so when she draws those trajectories, those arches of, okay, that's how high the redstone can go, and that's how high the other one can go, that to me, I was like, okay, you can visually, anyone can visually see how high the rocket can go. Mm-hmm. And then it just became, how do we, you know, explain re-entry, or that, you know, getting the landing location of this capsule, that you've got so much ocean on this planet and you have to just land it within 25 miles. I mean, that's a really hard thing to do. So so I understood all of the theory, but if you asked me to actually, I did get her paper. It was about the azimuth angle. And I was like, oh, I'm going to totally read this. Because, I mean, I, you know, took calculus classes and everything at Stanford, and couldn't even get through the variables. And what it made me realize was just the breadth of knowledge that these women had to have. You know, it's not just the one equation. It's knowing the 15, you know, equations before that, and then the 100 variables that have been, you know, decided upon and named and their derivations. And I was just like, okay, can't even get through the first page.
Right, right. Yeah, I guess you just have to write about it at some point.
You do. You do. Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's talk a little bit more about your process and, you know, what it's like for you starting a script. I guess maybe we'll stick to a feature. I know there might be a difference between feature and TV, but how do you start a feature? What's that like for you?
I mean, normally I just get the main arc of the character, so I know where I'm going. So in this case, it was very clear that Catherine was going to end up running the numbers for John Glenn and joining the space task group. And in real life, when she first joined the space task group, she sat next to a white engineer, and he sort of gave her this look and moved away. And she said, I could have either believed he left because I was black or because he had something better to do. And I chose to believe the latter. And so I thought, okay, I know Catherine. She's got a quiet dignity to her. She's going to keep persevering. And this is about her in the space task group. And then with Mary Jackson, it was all about her becoming an engineer and petitioning the court. And with Dorothy Vaughan, it was the coming technology and transitioning her girls to programming. So then I just, you know, beated out the different beats of their story and started intertwining them. And that was how the first few drafts went.
Wow. So do you wind up doing a major outline, or are you not of that school?
I don't anymore, because I find if I do a really detailed outline, it becomes so laborious to write the script, because I'm like, oh, I already know it. Why do I have to get it out? Why can't I just morph it from my brain to the page? So I now try and leave myself a lot more creativity in the actual writing process to keep me going. So it's mainly just their main beats, and then I see what happens.
I have to imagine that has something to do with you coming from a background in science, math, concrete things. that you kind of, your brain's doing the concrete part on its own, whether you want it to or not.
Right. Right. Yeah. No, I mean, even when I go up for a lot of thrillers, right? And for me, what's laborious is all the red herrings and the clues and being logic police and making sure everything tracks and that the audience isn't ahead of me. And I'll go pitch these incredibly intricate plots. And then they'll be like, what about character? And I'm like, character? Character I can do all day. Mm-hmm. Like, character is easy. And for me, and dialogue and all that is easy. I'm like, what's hard is making sure that the intricate plot sort of holds together. So with this, which was so much of a character and an ensemble piece, it was nice to just get to sort of sink into a scene and see where it went.
That's cool. Well, what makes character and dialogue easy for you? It's certainly not easy for everybody.
I don't know. I think that I've been very lucky to have projects with some very interesting protagonists, and obviously these were real women, so I could read everything about them. And then with Agatha Christie, I could read so much about her. And so, or I sort of, it's just the type of protagonist that I want to see on the screen. So I feel like I know them very well. And then with dialogue, I think part of that comes from my improv background and my theater background, where I'm used to sort of having to think so quickly on my feet. But yes, it drove my husband crazy. He's a television writer. So he's used to, I mean, they will argue over a line of dialogue for hours. And as a feature writer who sits alone on her sofa, you know, I get to make all the calls myself. And I'm like, he'll be like, I have a really big note. I'll be like, okay. And I'm terrified because, you know, the script's supposed to go out the next day. And he's like, this one line of dialogue just really bumps me, and let me tell you why. And he'll just start on his monologue of why, and I'll already be changing the line of dialogue to what he suggested, and I think it's a great change, and I'll be done. He's like, no, but we haven't argued through it. And I'm like, hun, it's fine. I made the change. So when I carded out Hidden Figures, I was like, I'm gonna card it out tomorrow. And I had my yellow cards for Dorothy and my red cards for Catherine, and he came home, and I was like, okay, I'm all done. He's like, you carded for 2 hours. I'm like, yep, I'm all done. It's a very different method of writing, for sure.
Right. What does that look like? Where do you actually use your cards? How do you make that work?
I just did it on the floor of my living room. Wow. I don't do it that often, but because it was, you know, ensemble, and Ted did the same thing. We both were, you know, carding out the characters and intertwining the stories, because, you know, you have to make sure everyone's taken care of. So, but normally I just sort of write a beat sheet or an outline and get going. If it's, you know, assignment work, open assignment work, though, as many writers will tell you nowadays, you have to do a lot of free work. So in those cases, I often have a complete outline done before I even start.
Let's talk about that a little bit. I mean, I know it's free work and it's just kind of the way it works, but you're doing outlines to try to get yourself the job. Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah.
You never turn them in. But essentially what ultimately ends up being your pitch, so you do pitches, you do verbal pitches, is you sort of do a little bit, and then the producers come back and they want more and more and more. And I swear, you'll find yourself 3 months later thinking, I just broke this entire feature into outline form, not once, not twice, but three times. And a lot of times it's a bummer because those projects ultimately end up going nowhere, and they don't hire anyone, and you sort of stare at this movie that you've grown very close to, and you put it back in a drawer and tuck it away.
Wow.
And that's just the nature of the beast these days. But you memorize your outline, and you go in and you pitch it. And a lot of young writers always say to me, well, when I go in, sometimes the people want to keep the outline, you know, and you really don't want to do that. You don't want to leave anything written behind. And I always say, oh, I write all over my little notes and I highlight on it. So that when they ask for it, I'm like, oh, it's a mess. I should get you a clean copy. And then you just never have to send the clean copy.
What is the harm in leaving something behind?
I mean, I think it depends. But you don't want to leave. I mean, first of all, if you're in the Writers Guild, you know, you don't want to be turning in free outlines and free treatments. That's just not what you want to do. And I think that that's important to not give away the free work. You know, if you've got like a one-page summary or something that they're going to shop around and see if there's interest in, I think, you know, a paragraph or two is fine. But you don't want to give it away. You know, you've worked hard on that. So protect yourself.
Oh, cool. That's great advice. So what are some of the other things that changed? I mean, you mentioned Ted Melfi, the director. What are some of the other things that changed as other people started getting involved?
Well, one of the big things that was really fun for me personally was when I started with Donna Gelati. This was a very small movie. And so she was like, we can't go into space. We don't have the budget for space. So I need you to cut to TVs and we'll throw our, you know, archive footage on it. And ultimately there is still, you know, a lot of archive footage. But when Ted came on board and Fox 2000 came on board and everything, suddenly we could go to space. And so that was just really exciting because of course you want to cut to John Glenn in the capsule, right? And get to see him, you know, getting into the capsule on top of the rocket. So that was just really fun that the scope of it could get bigger with parades and stuff. And then as the actors came on board, you know, you start tailoring a little bit more and more to who's coming on board. So Jim Parsons and Kirsten Dunst, you know, both of their characters could become a little bit bigger and a little bit more integral to the story.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that I thought was nice, there was a nice balance of kind of a limited perspective of the people who are on the ground trying to make things work and trying to crunch numbers, where we don't spend the whole time in space.
No, not at all.
So there was a nice balance of that. I didn't notice that how little time we actually spent in space. I mean, I know you got more than you thought you would, but...
Right. And that was always the point, right? That we were showing a different side of this story that we know so well. And to me, that's actually one of the most fun things for me in writing. And it's something I've done in other scripts where you take a piece of history that you think you know so well and then just switch the angle, switch the POV, and learn it from a new perspective. I think it's always a fun way to relook at history.
That's great. Well, I have one last question before I want to change topics. But if there's one thing that you would want the audience to know about this story or about this movie that they're not going to get from watching it, what would that thing be?
I think my biggest thing is that their story didn't end. And I think that that's really important because I think we sometimes get these movies and our protagonist has this big victory and it seems like they ride off into the sunset happily ever after. And that's not how life works, right? That once you have one success, you still need to work hard for the next one. And so these women, you know, went on to work on the Apollo missions and some of them ended up leaving their engineering and math positions and working in the employment equality office to advance the careers of other women. And so It's not like Catherine just, after that moment, everything was smooth sailing for her, right? Mm-hmm. That there continued to be obstacles in her way, and she overcame them again and again and again. And I think that's, and then the next generation came in, and it wasn't easy for them either, and they had to keep persevering. And I think we just need to remind each other of that nobody's life is perfect, right? And everybody's still pushing ahead.
Right. I mean, there's no such thing as an ending.
That's right. There's no such thing as an ending. Well, I mean, I guess in some ways, but, you know, but other than the final curtain, I think that's important to just remember that their journeys continued after this and they did great things, but there were still hardships.
That's great. So, look, I promised I would get into talking about something else, but I want to go back to Pineapple Express because...
All right, let's do it.
You mentioned that was a great, fun job, so I want to hear about that. What was that like, and you know, what was your... What stage of life were you at in your career, and...
Well, I had just... Let's see, I'd graduated from USC Film School, and I could not get a job. I mean, I could not get a job being anyone's assistant, being a PA. I mean, I was willing to do just anything within the industry. So I was tutoring to make ends meet. And one of my friends from USC knew that they were looking for a production assistant at Pineapple Express. And so I went in and interviewed. And I think there were like 18 of us or something that interviewed. I mean, there were a lot of people. And my boss said she hired me because of the outfit I wore.
Wow.
I thought that was fascinating. And she said, you know, you came wearing jeans and a nice top and flats, but nice flats. So I knew you were there for an interview and you needed to be professional, but you also made it clear that you understood your job was going to be running errands. And I thought, wow, I did good. And I had thought about all of that. And then we just had an interview where she said, you know, you just seemed like you could do the job, which is actually sometimes hard to find. So I became a a production assistant on it. And I'd actually, I'd been a financial analyst for 2 years before film school. So I took that off my resume because I think that scared absolutely everybody in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And it was just such a wonderful job because I guess in some ways the requirements of me, the job requirements in comparison to being a financial analyst, were just so laid back that I thought, this is great. Like, this is my job is to just do the groceries and stock the fridge and make sure everyone's happy and pick up the lunch and drop off the dailies and, you know, run to set and make gift baskets. And they would joke with me, though, because they would give me a simple task like, hey, can you just like put some toiletries together in a basket for all of the talent's trailers? And I would be like, yes. And the next thing you know, I'm doing like origami towels because I wanted to have fun with it, you know, mm-hmm. and I wanted to do the best. And people noticed. I mean, people really noticed. And as a result, I would just be in the elevator and the producer would just start talking to me and take an interest in the fact that I did want to be a writer. And it was just such a nice experience and such a good group of people. And then I ultimately went on to Smallville to be a writer's production assistant there. And it was equally wonderful. And they would, you know, let me sit in the room and hear them break story. And that's where I learned a lot about how to break a television show. You know, and then ultimately, you know, let a bunch of us pitch for a freelance episode. And so I think it's incredibly valuable to be an assistant. And I think it also is very good when you start advancing in your career to be kind to others. Mm-hmm. I think is my big thing.
Yeah, I guess you learn the value of that when you're on the receiving end.
You do. I mean, my manager's assistant is very sweet. And if I call like really, really excited about something and my manager's not available, poor Dave gets stuck, you know, listening to it. But I think, you know, I asked him one day, I'm like, am I the annoying client? You know, and he said, no, you're the nice client. Mm. And that was everything.
That's cool. Honestly.
Yeah.
That sounds like a really great place for us to leave it. Thank you so much for joining us, Allison Schroeder.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So you can check out Hidden Figures in theaters now. I highly recommend it. You're still listening to the Final Draft Insider View, the podcast where we bring you special bonus episodes where we have two different people to talk to about Hidden Figures today. I'm still your host, P.T. Alessandro, but our next guest is director Ted Melfi, who also has screenplay credit on Hidden Figures. If you want to hear a little bit more about Ted, yes, we have covered him before. We've talked to him about his last movie, St. Vincent. So catch up if you want to. We're going to jump right in with Ted. Ted, thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Can you catch us up on how you came to this project? The last time we talked to you, you know, St. Vincent was just out, and what's happened since then?
Well, the project came to me from a book proposal by Margot Lee Shetterly. Margot ended up writing the novel, Hidden Figures. And her father was a research scientist at NASA. And so she grew up, you know, 20 minutes from NASA Langley campus. And she also grew up with Katherine Johnson, Dorothy Vaughan, and Mary Jackson as in backyard barbecues and social events. And so she grew up with this curiosity of these women and wanted to know who they were. And her dad would always say, well, those were our mathematicians. So she became instantly interested in them and spent 6 years researching everything there was to know about these three women and started writing this book. That book proposal made its way to Donna Gelati, who has a great track record of finding, you know, great material. She produced The Reader, Shakespeare in Love, and Silver Linings Playbook, you know, among many others, but those are the three best known. And she fell in love with the book proposal. She commissioned a first draft, which Allison wrote. That first draft by Allison and the book proposal made it to UTA, and that made it to me. And I read it over a weekend and was, like everyone else, floored, you know, just stunned. I said, there's no way there were women at NASA in 1961 and 62. And everyone said, yes, there were, and they were black women. And I said, and you're even more stunned. Because everything you see, every Apollo 13 movie or documentary or every piece of the space race you see whether it be archival, historical, or cinematic, there's not a woman to be seen unless there's a wife of an astronaut. So I was shocked by it and also angered by it and moved by it. So it was just, I had to be involved. I had to find out how to be involved and to do these women justice.
I'm curious, when you pick up a script like that over the weekend, do you know what you're, you open page one, do you know what you're reading yet, or do you have any idea, or is it just totally blind?
Well, no, my agents called me on that Friday night and pitched it to me because they wanted me to really read it fast. And so they gave me the pitch, and I was like, no, kid, are you kidding me? And they said, no, it's true. And so I knew going in that there were these group of female computers, as they were called, that did the work and did the math. So I knew what it was about going in.
Okay. So then what's your first step? I mean, you're excited about it. You're interested in the project. What is the next thing you do?
Well, it was a twofold attack, a two-pronged attack. I had to start writing right away around Labor Day of 2015. I started writing right away, and as I was writing, I planned some trips. I went to NASA Langley's campus in Hampton, Virginia, and toured the entire campus inside and out. Saw the actual West Computing Group building, the segregated building at that time. Mm-hmm. Saw the wind tunnels. Saw all of NASA, and then spent several hours with the real Katherine Johnson.
Wow.
Who at the time was 97, and I spent a great deal of time with her and dug into who she was and explored her life and her through her eyes and through her eyes of her children.
What do you wind up taking away from that research? What wound up sticking with you the most?
What wound up sticking? I asked Catherine. I said, Catherine, what was it like to experience racism and sexism in the workplace when you were there in NASA in the 1950s and 60s. And she looked at me like I was crazy. And she said, what? She goes, no, I didn't experience any of that. I just put my head down, I did my work, and everyone was so nice to me. And I'll never forget those words. It showed me the fortitude of this woman and how she did the work and let her pencil do all of the talking for her and put her head down and drove straight through the Jim Crow South and the segregated parts of NASA and broke barriers with her pencil quietly, which was to me like a beautiful testament to the courage of her.
Yeah, for sure. What do you wind up doing after you take that research home? What did you wind up changing in the script or writing from that original draft you'd read?
Well, the third act, Allison and I always knew. The third act we knew was kind of like locked in stone. It's historical. It's the Mercury missions. It's Alan Shepard goes up, becomes the first man in suborbit, first American in suborbit. Gus Grissom goes up, and then his capsule sinks, and it's the end of it's a tragedy. And then John Glenn becomes the first American to circle the Earth in orbit. You also know the beginning, middle, and end of each character, of each one of our three female leads. We knew that Katherine Johnson was the only one that John Glenn trusted to run her numbers, to confirm his numbers. That's a direct quote in the movie. Mm-hmm. That John Glenn says, get the girl to run the numbers. If she says they're good, I'm good to go. So we know where she's going to end up, right? And we know where she starts. What we didn't know was who they were to each other and how they interacted with each other and what their family lives were. And so that's the stuff that I kind of dove into. And also who they were as human beings. I wrote the opening cop scene, so which sets up all of the characters in one scene, like who they are personality-wise, how they would act, how they talk, and what makes them tick. So I focused on their home lives and the balance of home life and work together.
That's great. I mean, that really comes across, especially through that second act, and we get that they are being pulled in two directions. There are things outside of just going to work and clocking in. You know, there are parts of Catherine's life that aren't defined by that pencil.
Exactly. Which I thought was would be crucial to the film because, you know, at the end of the day, if you don't care for the women, you know, at home, you won't care for them at work. I mean, you know, we're not defined by our work. We're defined by how we treat our family and our loved ones. And so, you know, I felt it important for us to see her life and see her as a single mom that she was. And that created a lot of empathy for her so that when she picked up a piece of chalk or a pencil, you really cared about what she was doing.
Now, you've worked on plenty of stuff where you've been a writer, you've worked on plenty of stuff when you've been writer-director. What's different here? What starts to inform you as a director and what starts to inform your writing from that?
Yeah. Well, you know, as a director, I have a very simple philosophy, kind of a philosophy I've adopted from the stage, from the theater. It's like the script is the boss. So the script tells the director, a good script will tell a director everything he needs to know about how to direct it, how it should look, what the angles should be, what the wardrobe should be, who the actors are, how the actors should act. The script tells you. It tells you everything. So I spend all of my time early on making the script exactly what I think it is. And then the directing becomes just servicing that script. I have a big problem with, you know, being defined as a director because I don't know if a director should be defined. A director should take a piece of material and be a service to the piece of material. If a director, in my mind, is putting his stink or his style into every single script he's doing, he's servicing himself. And not servicing the material. So I try to become a vessel for it. And, you know, this movie really early on felt classic to me. You know, the script felt classic. It felt like a classic story. It was a space race. It was 1961. It was the Cold War. It was the Jim Crow South. It was U.S. segregation. It was JFK. It was Martin Luther King. It's not handheld. It's not jumping around. It's not gaudy. It's classic storytelling. So I chose a classic storytelling style that I don't normally do. I don't normally shoot like that. I definitely don't shoot commercial work like that. But we did that, and we shot on film because we wanted to have this classic look. And all the decisions down along the way were in service to the script.
Right. I mean, it definitely doesn't feel like, I was just thinking back on St. Vincent. It's not, they're not the same style in many ways. It's the material first.
Well, yeah, I don't think you'd look at St. Vincent and this one together and think it was the same director. I don't think you would.
No.
You'd go, yeah, it's not. So I was in service to the script in St. Vincent, and that was a comedy. That was more comedic, and so the lenses are different, and the look is different, and the styling is different than Hidden Figures. And the next one I do will be completely different than both of these.
And let's be clear here. You're not saying that, you know, in the script it's written, all right, now there's going to be a high angle shot, and we'll boom down and zoom in a little bit. It's apparent from the story and from what's going on in those scenes that your choices are kind of dictated from that, right?
Yeah, the script tells you the tone.
Yeah.
And the tone tells you the shot. Hmm. You know, if the, you know, the script felt epic, right? So we shot anamorphic. I mean, that's just a direct, you know, almost direct translation. You know, the script felt epic. You're watching a bigger story, something you didn't know, and it was hidden. So what does that mean cinematically? Well, to me, it meant very wide angle lenses, very wide shots, anamorphic, 35mm film, and there'd be a lot of barriers. So we're shooting always through windows or doors or doorways or other people, parts of other people's bodies. There's a lot of stuff shot through things.
That's really neat. I wasn't totally aware of that. That's fantastic. What else starts changing when you're on set, when you're starting to actually shoot this?
Well, I mean, every day something changes. An actor comes up with a better idea for blocking or a better approach to the scene. A location handcuffs you and puts you in a place where you can only shoot it one way and you thought you could shoot it another way. A camera blows up and you have to jump, you have to jump to a different scene with a different camera, or it starts to rain as it did in Georgia and you're on a car and you're like, okay, well, that's not going to work. So every day is like, improv. Every day is an improv. And you're either able to roll with it or you're not. So, it's all in the planning. I mean, every single frame of this movie is storyboarded. There are over 800 frames. And you then have the ability to jump all around whenever you need to, and you know how it all ties together. So it's just about having a good plan, executing.
Is that's normally how you work?
Yeah. Yeah, I storyboard every frame of St. Vincent as well. I storyboard every frame of every commercial I've ever done. I just think you have to see it, and everyone has to see it and talk about it and understand it, and then you're all on the same page.
That's great. What were some of the specific challenges in this? I mean, in telling the story, what were some of the hard parts?
The hard parts, the two hardest parts are getting dealing with the segregation aspects of it and the racist aspects of it. We wanted to deal with racism and segregation in a way that you had not seen before, because we've all seen the lynchings and the cross burnings and the fire hoses. We've all seen that in cinema many, many times, and this was a different, this was a way to explore that from a different side of it, from a side of institutional racism. Mm-hmm. The looks and the slights and the segregated bathrooms and the not getting credit or pay or promotions, all the things that happened in the pleasant hallways of corporate America business. And so to us, that was really important. Yet we didn't want to, completely walk away from or not harken back to the bigger civil rights movement or the more public civil rights movement that was happening at the time. And so we had a couple pops of that as well. There was a little protest that Octavia Spencer walks through with her children. Mm-hmm. And then we have the Freedom Riders on the bus burning on a TV and Martin Luther King Jr. talking about it. So we try to balance both of them, but definitely weighted on the racism that you had not seen as much cinematically. The second biggest challenge was just juggling the sheer number of storylines. There's three women storylines at work and what they wish to achieve, and three women storylines at home, and the three women storylines together, and then NASA and all the launches. And somehow get enough of the fear of the Cold War and the Russian hacking and the Russian nuclear threat and the segregation and the Jim Crow laws as well. It's a lot of stuff. That's why the movie felt so epic to me. It's like it's an American quilt, this movie, an American quilt with all these moving parts, and now through the eyes of three amazing black women. So that was all a big challenge to juggle that properly.
Yeah, I want to get into process a little bit. I mean, I don't think we got to talk about this in our last podcast because you weren't coming into a movie that already had a script, that already had a writer. But what's your process like here? I mean, do you go back to outlining, or do you go back to index cards? What do you start with after you get that research?
Allison having already done the first draft, we had a very reliable outer structure to start with. So especially as I said earlier, the third act was a known. Mm-hmm. I went to note cards, which I haven't done note cards in a few years, but mm-hmm. I went to note cards and put each character as a different color. So you had Catherine, Dorothy, and Mary as different colors. And then I had a different color for NASA. And I just put out, I wrote out their scenes or what they thought their scenes would be, what their beats would be, and I put them on note cards, and I put them up on a wall, and I just started shuffling with my wife Kimberly Quinn and with Marissa Paiva, our executive at Fox 2000, and we spent the half a day in a room together, and just kind of juggled all these cards, trying to find the right balance, and actually came up with it. And then I went off and kept going.
To a point where it's more or less crystallized?
Yeah, more or less. We walked out of there, and very little changed after that. I mean, yeah, I moved a couple scenes around. And then you start getting involved with the actors and the casting process. And in that casting process, you realize that this scene's working or not working. And you also realize as you cast an actor, okay, they need this and they don't need that. Working with Kevin Costner was one of the great experiences of my life, because Kevin digs into every piece of material and chews on it and spits it out, and we all look at it, and he really helps it become a great, you know, crafted piece that's servicing the whole, which is, you know, not what you expect from an actor. They want to service themselves. Kevin always wanted to service the whole.
That's great. What were some of the changes he'd pitched or he'd thought?
He felt that, you know, without he really wanted Harrison to be the guy who could give a crap what anyone's color was. He had a mission, and that mission was to put a man in orbit. And so he had a cutthroat philosophy. If you could do the work, you had value. If you couldn't, go home. Mm-hmm. Which is really, to be honest with you, the truest representation of the white male management at NASA at the time. It was NASA at that time, through all our research, was like an absolute meritocracy. Your work and your merit, you know, took you wherever it had to go, wherever you could go. And when your work and your merit couldn't take you any further, that's where you stayed.
Yeah, I mean, I really felt that, especially watching his character, there's just so much pressure that I don't have time to care who you are.
Yeah, he doesn't care what color you are, what sex you are. Yet he's complicit in it, right?
Yeah.
Which is what makes it complicated. He's complicit in it because although we think he doesn't see, he's omnipotent and he sees everything. He just doesn't care. So it's just not important to his mission.
Right.
But when he's told to care, he can no longer, when Katherine Johnson yells at him for having to traverse to the bathrooms 20 minutes and back, because there's no colored restroom for her in that building, he is forced to deal with it head on. And he does deal with it head on. So it's a complicated part for Kevin, and he did such a great job at it.
Yeah, it was not glazed over. He was not, I mean, he could have been a villain, he could have been a saint, and there wasn't any of that. He was a human.
Yeah, yeah. He's just a guy doing his job.
Yeah. Well, what are some of the other big surprises that happened for you? What are some of the other things you didn't expect to learn or expect to find?
Oh, there's so many surprises. You know, one big casting surprise for me was the little girl that plays young Catherine, Lydia Jouett, at the beginning of the film, is a pure genius. And, you know, she did all that math and memorized it and knew it and came to set on our very first day of shooting and did that in one take. And the entire crew had its tongues on the ground. We were shocked. We had a million surprises like that. That every day something magnificent would happen. What was a really great blessing and surprise was how close the cast and crew became so fast.
Wow.
Our cast became like a family, in love with each other so fast that those scenes with Taraji, Octavia, and Janelle are so wonderful to watch, the chemistry of them together, because they all truly love each other.
That's great.
And that was created by 2 weeks of rehearsal and everyone on the set for the right reason.
Right. Oh, that's great. So at this point, I mean, you guys are nominated for a ton of stuff, Oscars, BAFTAs, everything. What's going on now with the movie? I mean, are you hands off, sitting back, relaxing, or is there a lot more to do?
I haven't had a day off in 4.5 months. I got Christmas day off. Christmas, the day after Christmas, I had a Q&A. So, I mean, you know, it's been endless. No, we're still working hard, and, you know, with the Academy nominations and such, it's even double the work and double the press and double the interview kind of stuff. And no complaints. The movie, it just crossed over $121 million. And, you know, no one could have seen that coming for a $25 million movie. The studio's beside itself, and everyone just wants to keep going. I mean, you just kind of ride it out until it's done, and it'll be done February 27th.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I'm really curious that, I mean, it is one of those middle budget movies that we're told studios don't like to make anymore, because middle budget is, it's not $1 million, it's not $200 million. Was that a battle you guys had to fight along the way?
No, they always want, Elizabeth Gabler was always true to her word. She said, I'm making the movie. I'm going to make the movie. The only thing I ask you is, she said, I can't make the movie for $40 million. It doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. And I agreed with her. I said, it doesn't make sense either. I agree with you. So we just said we'd get it done for a price, and we did it for $25. And all of the actors did it for way below their quotes. And they all bet on themselves. And we all bet on ourselves. And the studio was very gracious and gave everyone a proper back end that now will be fully realized for everyone. So it's gonna, you know, everyone will be in success, sharing in the financial reward of making a great film.
That's great. Well, before we wrap up, can you tell us what's next for you?
I'm writing something for Fox 2000 now called Fruit Loops, and it's the story of a mental institution upstate New York.
Sounds fun. Well, Ted, thank you so much for joining us. This has been great to have you back on.
Great to be here. Thanks again for having me.
All right. And if you're out there listening, please let us know if you like the podcast by leaving a rating or review on iTunes. And until next time, happy writing.